You know, but I'll call her and help that, so. I know there's a lot of reasons that God sent you here. But when mommy got sick, I believe that she didn't have a clue who you were when you first came. And you didn't tell her your name or anything, I don't think. But I believe that God sent you there because he knew he was taking her home. And she needed someone at that moment. And I believe that's why I sent you there. And she never lost faith.
Yeah, that she did. Boy, she made me check mine. Not my salvation, but boy, she made me check myself. All my close to death, and my, you know. I always say, and I still say, well, I'm ready to go, but I ain't looking for no spread line. But that lady was ready to go. I mean, not making light of that.
No,
like
she,
that.
She was.
No way.
We know she was.
But I've never heard anybody cry out like that. She just come and get, she ready. She knew she had better things than him.
Mm-hmm.
That to me is probably one of the greatest testimonies I ever heard. I heard her saying that. And she knew, man, she knew. That no so-so or say-so salvation or whatever they said, that no so salvation, however they put that, but she knew. She knew. She knew where she was going. She knew her destiny. Amen. She knew her God. She knew her God.
And when they took the life support off of her, she came out of the life support, sang an Amazing Grace.
Amen. We got that on tape.
Amen. Amen.
Recorded it.
Amen. It just amazed me that time we was up there. I think the first time I met Buddy. Mm-hmm. Down in the hospital, was in that room. She was just so weak. You was even feeding. And then Chris, remember Chris played that song? I can't remember what song it was. I don't know what it was. Man, that lady, she raised both hands praising the Lord. Wow. Working her out. This is some awesome stuff. But she was that weak. She was going. I'm going to get them arms up to praise her God. Amen. She's going to get to praise her God. Amen. Anybody else?
And the same thing with Brother Rod. He, you know, he was so weak. But I remember the last, and he would come to church faithfully. And the last, and he would always get up there and play the guitar no matter what. And, you know, if you don't believe in God, things like that is enough to show you there's an Almighty God.
Amen.
Because He takes control.
Amen. 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 Anybody else? Anybody else? Amen. You know, we talked about that's how she was ready to go. Sometimes we all fear death. And you're scared. Death scared me to death.
Yeah.
The fear. But once you get that personal relationship, once you get that fellowship back with God through His Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that makes a big difference. I know she was, Sister Eleanor? Sister Eleanor was ready to go. I believe she was waiting to take that step. Amen. She was ready to take that step. To promise. She was ready to take that step to paradise. Amen. As Jesus told the thief on the cross, today, not tomorrow, but today, you will be with me in paradise. Amen. You want to open up your Bibles to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 20 this morning. the book of 1 Samuel chapter 20. We're going to be reading the first three verses this morning. God is so good to us. Amen. And I believe that step that Sister Elmore took, there wasn't a hesitation to that step. That's what she touched my life in so many ways in a short period of time. Amen. First time I've ever been behind a pulpit, somebody called me a short fella. Little fella up there. And she was just speaking the truth. Well, I believe that she took that step. She took that step without hesitation. Amen. And we're going to get there. But she had to take a step before that. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 20. Verse 1, reading down through, and including verse 3. It says, "And Daniel came from Naoth and Ramoth, and came and said before Jonathan, 'What have I done? What is my iniquity? And what is it my sin? What is my sin before thy father that he seeketh my life?'" Now this is when Saul was out to kill David. David and Jonathan kind of got a bomb there. And that's what they're speaking of here. "And he said unto him, 'God forbid that thou shalt not die.'" And this is Jonathan speaking. "Behold, my father will do nothing, either great or small, but that he will show it me. And why should my father hide this things from me? It is not so. And David sware moreover and said, 'Thy father certainly knoweth that I have found grace in thine eyes.' And he saith, 'Let not Jonathan know this, lest he be grieved. But truly as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, there is but a step between me and death.'" Amen. Precious Heavenly Father, we call upon you one more time. We just pray, Father, once again. Father, you just use this old vessel, Lord. Allow the Holy Spirit to speak through this vessel, Father. Get out of the way, Lord. We come and ask these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I want to preach just a little bit this morning on just one step. Amen. Just one step. David said it when he said, "There is but a step between me and death." As I spoke a little bit about Sister Eleanor, she was ready to take that step. That one step that one day we're all going to take that step. Yeah. It's going to take us from here to our eternal destination. Amen. But there comes a time that Sister Eleanor had to make a choice at some point in her life to take that step. So she was secure in her salvation, secure in her eternal destiny, that she had to take a step. Amen. We've all got a choice this morning. We're either going to take one step toward the Father or one step further away from the Father. I begin to think about some people that took some steps. Amen. You think about that rich young ruler in Mark 10, Matthew 16, and Luke 18. That rich young ruler went up to Jesus and asked him. He said, "Good one," or I can't remember the quote, the scriptures. He says, "What do I need to secure my eternal life with God?" That's the Hebrew version. Look it up. Amen.
Yeah.
But he said, "Follow the commandments." He said about four or five commandments. The rich young ruler said, "I've followed all of those my whole life." You see, he was following the law. He thought he was okay. But Jesus said, "Go and give half all your goods to the poor." And the rich young ruler had many things, and he didn't want to do that. So he turned around. After Jesus said that, he turned around and took one step away from Jesus. Amen. One step away from Jesus determined where he was going to spend eternity. Amen. Not that God didn't give him another chance, but God didn't have to give him another chance when he turned and took that step away from Jesus. Amen. Where's your steps at this morning? Is your steps toward the Father or away from the Father? I begin to think about Judas. in the Garden of Gethsemane. Amen. He sold out Jesus. He sold out his soul for 30 pieces of silver. Jesus had went to the Garden of Gethsemane with his disciples to pray. And when he prayed, Father, if this any way this cup can pass away from me, and I don't have to do it, let it go. If not, your will be done. Shortly after that, he went and tuned the disciples up as they fell asleep, right in the Garden of Gethsemane. They say Jesus was so troubled that his sweat became like blood, drops of blood. But as soon as he got up and went back to the disciples, here comes Judas, amen. He told the Pharisees, oh God, the one you're looking for, I'll step up and give him a kiss, amen. It doesn't say that in the Bible. Well, listen, it's a little bit of common sense. If you're going to kiss somebody, you've got to step toward them. Amen. I believe he went to the garden that day. And when they all gathered around, I believe he stepped up to give Jesus a kiss. Amen. He stepped forward. Amen. But he didn't stay forward. He stepped forward for the wrong reason. Amen. Let me tell you something. If you're coming to an altar of prayer to please somebody, to get somebody off your back, you're stepping toward Jesus for the wrong reason. Because your destiny is in the same place you had before you got up to step toward Jesus.
Yes.
You can't do it. You can't take a step toward Jesus for somebody else. Because you're just trying to make mom and dad happy. It's not one of my favorite things, but I've been at the altar. And what happens at the altar is between that person and God. But I'm telling you, it's over the years. I can tell who took that step to the altar for their mom or dad or grandma or grandpa or her husband or their wife that just took that step. Your step's got to mean something. But I begin to think about that. Just one step. Just one step is all it took. Just one step for them to turn their back on Jesus and walk away. Amen. Today, what step are we going to take? What step are we going to take? I'm beginning to think about old Zacchaeus, the story of Zacchaeus. Jesus was passing through Jericho one day. Zacchaeus was short in stature. He's a little fella. Amen. And he wanted to see Jesus. Amen. So he found him a big sycamore tree. Amen. And he took that first step up on the first limb of the sycamore tree, amen. He was taking a step toward Jesus, amen. He was taking a step to find out where his eternity would be that day, amen. You can take a step toward the altar, but that doesn't secure your righteousness with God the Father. But Zacchaeus didn't get saved when he took that first step. Amen. He didn't get saved when he took that first step. He got saved when he took the second step. You say the second step? When he took that second step, when he took a step to get down out of that tree, he had his salvation. You say, how can you prove that? Oh, Jesus told him to come down, Zacchaeus. Amen. Some say he didn't get saved until he got home. I say he was saved when he took that step out of the tree.
Yeah.
Amen. Jesus knew his heart. When he took that first step to get up the tree. Amen. That was his path to salvation. When he took the second tree, because Jesus said to Zacchaeus, come down, make haste. I need to go to your house today. He was telling him. It's just the hillbilly version. I believe he got saved when he took that first step up the tree. Because he was willing to do what when he came down out of the tree? Follow Jesus.
Yeah.
You're not going to follow Jesus if you're not saved. Amen. When he took that first step up the tree, to get his eyes on Jesus, the one he had heard about. Now you can split hairs whenever he got his salvation, but he got it. He got it. If you'll read on down through there, when he was at his house, read on down through there. Get in your Bible and read it. I begin to think about that man at the pool of Bethesda. Had his infirmity for 38 years. Now the pool of Bethesda was at the sheep gate. And it was a pool where those who were sick and lame went. And every now and then God would send down an angel to stir the water. And the first one to take that first step and get in the pool was healed. Amen. But this man could not move enough because Jesus was talking to him. He told Jesus. He says, every time the pool stirs, somebody gets that first step on me and I can't get in the pool. Amen. And Jesus touched him that day. Amen. He was taking that first step toward Jesus. Amen. Because Jesus said, you don't need to take that step to that pool anymore. I'm the way to healing. Amen. I'm the way that's going to heal your body. I'm the one that's going to forgive your sins. And Jesus told him, he said, how do you know he got saved? Because Jesus said, take up your mat and take that first step, brother. You're free, amen. You're healed from all iniquities. Amen. When he took that first step, you can take all the steps you want. Amen. You can take all the steps you want, jump in any pool you want to jump into. Amen.
Yeah.
It's not going to do you a bit of good. A lot of people think they'll take that and just take their steps about that. A lot of people think they're just going to walk into heaven. Amen. They think, I'm going to take these steps. I'm a good person. I go to church. I give to the church. I help people out. I'm always the first one to volunteer. Not going to get you there. You can take all the steps you want. The man couldn't even take a step. The man could not take a step to save himself. Every time the angel stirred up the pool at the sheep gate, somebody else beat him in. But Jesus showed up one day. Let me tell you something, it's a personal salvation.
Amen.
Jesus said, you don't need the pool. All you need to do is take that first step toward me. Well, then when he got up, he said, take your mat and go. Amen. He was so excited. He took that one step. And that day, that very day, that man found salvation. Amen. That very day, he found what step were you going? Just one step. Just one step is all it took.
Amen.
Just one step. Just one step is all it took. And Philip, over there in the book of Acts, chapter 8.
Make sure I'm in the right book.
God told him, Philip, I want you to take one step. And he just left me. Whatever the name of that road he was on. Amen. And he said, you go here. You take that step, Philip. I want you to go here. But you got to take the first step. He went where God told him to go. There he met an Ethiopian eunuch coming down from Jerusalem. He was up there worshiping. He was going back to Africa where he came from. He was a treasurer of Queen Cadmus or somebody. He was a treasurer. But he was on his way back.
you take that step toward that way. I need you to go there. Philip probably didn't understand why. He went up to the Ethiopian eunuch. So what are you reading? The Ethiopian eunuch was reading. He was reading Isaiah, I think, 53, 7 and 8. Where it says, I know I'm not going to get this right. Look it up. He was led like a sheep to slaughter. And he did not open his mouth. Now, I didn't do that justice. Amen. But that's where it is. Isaiah 50, 53, 7 and 8. Thank you.
Lord.
Amen. Amen. He says, who are they? Now, Ethiopian eunuch said, who are they speaking of here? And he went on to tell him the gospel message of Jesus Christ. It's just heavy on my heart this morning, amen. Amen.
Nice, sir.
Now, whatever God tells you to read, you read. Okay? And I was just reading over the scriptures this morning. And I looked. And my Bible said, the Hillbilly version, that he preached Jesus Christ to you. After he told him who he was reading about, my Bible says he preached Jesus to him. And the Ethiopian eunuch said, well, what keeps me from get baptized? And in my Bible it says, if thou believe. I'm just paraphrasing here. That Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Amen.
Amen. But I have another Bible sitting right next to me. I know this is getting a little off the beaten path. It's what the Lord laid out. I'm going to bring this up. Mm-hmm. But on this side was the King James Version. And on this side was the NIV. I ain't knocking nothing. Amen. Mm-hmm. If you pray, God will show you the right way.
Amen.
Amen. But in that NIV, when he asked the question, what do I need to do to be baptized? It goes straight to the river.
Yeah.
That's scary stuff. That's scary stuff. When you get to that point, when you're leaving that out of Scripture, it might make a lot of people mad, but when you leave that out of Scripture, there's something wrong.
Amen.
Y'all know I study and read out the New King James Version. Amen. But I see now, I'm like, this is wrong. To me, you know what that was telling me? If I go and be baptized, I'm okay. Amen. I tried to read it. I got another NIV. I tried to read it. I tried to give some kind of
justification
for leaving it out. Now, there's other stuff there too, but that just reached my soul to the point where I almost start crying. Mm-hmm. What happens if somebody reads this and all I got to do is be baptized? Mm-hmm. Come on, Johnny, dump me in this river and I'm okay. There's something wrong with that. You're skipping a step to salvation. I knew the Lord would bring it around full circle.
Yeah, there you go.
Amen. They were skipping a step to salvation. The only step to salvation. They left out Jesus.
Yeah. Amen.
Without that step to Jesus, there is no salvation.
Yeah.
You can get dumped all you want. Go to your swimming pool out back or your community swimming pool. Jump in. Two things are going to happen. He's going to cool you off. Or make you
wet.
That's a whole nother sermon there. That'll make you wet. Amen. Remember old Perry Bradford said, That don't get excited woods with. Amen. That's next week, son.
No, it ain't.
But you see, without that step toward Jesus, baptism means nothing. Baptism means nothing. Because he was just, without that, without him knowing Jesus Christ as his personal Savior, he might well just be skipping down the river. Yeah. Just go swimming. Amen. That's all he'd been doing. Well, that, you say I don't get so worked up over things, but that broke my heart. I begin to think, what do my grandchildren read this? Now, y'all know I'm no King James only, and there's nothing wrong. And I always, King James is, I've got all kinds of different Bibles I study. Amen.
Yep.
But I always go back to the King James. Amen. I always go back to the King James. Amen. And there might be some good old interpretations. But man, that just broke my heart. That broke my heart last night. I got it out again this morning. Man, I might be tired. Yesterday when I looked at it. It leaves it out. Without that step, there's no salvation. That's like getting up and coming to an altar. For somebody else. Amen. That's like coming, that's like kneeling down on the altar and saying, and not giving your life to Jesus Christ, not believing in your heart and confessing with your mouth that Jesus is the Son of God, is our Savior. Would you just look up? And I'm getting Johnny off my back. I got saved. Let's go get baptized. Amen. There's no difference there. There's no difference. They call it a personal relationship for a reason. Amen. You can fool all of us. You can almost even fool yourself. God will show you. God will show you in your heart. Amen. Amen. I honestly believe this. If you go to get baptized, I believe the Holy Ghost is right there. Amen. I just believe that. I believe the Holy Ghost. Because you're baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm just saying, I'm going to take a chance of going underwater to put on a show. Right. Amen. We'll leave it at that. I begin to think. Because you look, as we talked about Sister Eleanor. She was ready to take that step. There's only two people that's ever got out of taking that final step. Because you are going to take that final step unless Jesus comes back for his church. You are going to take that final step into eternity somewhere.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. You're going to take that final step. Amen. Just look in the book of Luke chapter 16. Just ask the rich man and Lazarus. You're going to take that final step.
Amen.
You're going to take a step today. You're going to take a step today. No matter where you're at or what you're doing. Because if you're hearing this message, you're going to take a step today.
Amen.
You're going to take a step toward Jesus. Or you're going to take a step away from Jesus.
Amen.
Not to be mean, but just look out at the rich young ruler, how it worked out for him.
Amen.
Ask Judas how it worked out for him. Ask the rich man.
Amen.
In Luke chapter 16. Amen. How it worked out for him. Ask him.
Right.
It didn't work out because it said when he woke up, you see, he took that step to his eternal destination. Where all will take. for his church.
Right.
We'll all take that step. It says when the rich man awoke, he was in Hades.
Amen.
And I can go a whole nother sermon on what Hades is all about. And about how Jesus emptied it 3 days. And by the way, a lot of people say Jonah is just a made-up story, a parable. It's either in Matthew 18 or 12. Jesus spoke of Jonah. As he says, that Jonah was 3 days
in the
belly of the fish.
Amen.
So will the Son of Man be 3 days in the center of the... That's when Jesus went to empty.
Right.
Went to empty Hades. If you go back and read some, study some things on Hades. It has two compartments. It had two compartments before Jesus died. The righteous, where Lazarus was, and the unrighteous, where the rich man was.
Amen.
Amen. But you see, before the rich man died, he never took a step toward God.
Right.
He never took a step toward Jesus. Amen. Well, there's no doubt about it. He probably went to the synagogues. I can't prove that. There's probably no doubt. Being a rich man, he probably had to find the seats in the synagogue. He may even have a library or something named after him in the synagogue. But he never took that step. He never took that step toward Jesus. But Lazarus did. Lazarus took that step toward Jesus. You say you got scripture to back that up? I haven't read anywhere where he took that step. Is there anything in the scriptures that says he took that step? I'm sure there is. Said it was in Abraham's bosom. We know he took that step and confessed Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Because he was in Abraham's bosom. It was what we now call and know as paradise. Amen. The rich man was still in Hades. Not hell. Hell's not open yet.
Amen.
But it's just as bad. It's just as bad. See, we're all going to take a step today. You're all going to take a step today. We're getting ready to open up the altar for prayer. You're going to take a step today. You say, preacher, that's some tough stuff. If you're within the hearing of my voice, if you've heard this message from God, don't you think this is from Paul? Don't you think this is from Apostle Paul Moles Jr.? Well, then I ain't that smart. This is straight from God. God's telling you today, you're going to take a step today.
Yeah.
Either you're going to take a step toward me, or you're going to turn your back and take a step from me. Just think about that. Ask Judas. Ask the rich young ruler. Ask the rich man. We can go on and on and on and on through scriptures. Ask the Pharisee, the Roman soldiers. It didn't work out. It didn't work out. But those who took that first step toward Jesus, that's all it takes. Just one step. You know that song? Just one look. Don't step to the saints. Best I can do.
Good.
And it fired off tune, off key. But just one step. Because you know what? I'm going to start preaching all over again. Because with just that one step, that's when you get that just one look to Jesus. Without that step, you're not going to see Jesus. You need to take that step toward Him. Salvation is bought, paid for, and free. But you got to take that step. You got to take that first step to get that one look, just one look. Let me tell you something, you just get one look at Jesus. You'll be hard pressed to take a step back. I'm going to say one now. Just a second. You'll be hard pressed if you just get that one look. Amen. But you don't get that one look. Well, you can see Jesus through us. Scripture tells us to be Christ-like. He definitely says he's like little children. Amen. But to get that look at the Savior, to get look at that glory, to get the look at that love,
Just one step. And I got this message me and Chris was talking earlier this week about salvation, about just stepping out. Just one step. Let me tell you something. If you're sitting in this seat right now and you're pondering this and that, let me tell you something. It's the same thing with me. When me and Chris was talking, it was that first step. I believe I was saved, forgiven, when I took that first step. Amen. I just had to finish it at the altar. Amen. God knew He had me when I took that first step. Amen. It was just that first step. Just that one step. The hardest thing, if you watch a baby when they're all clumsy and this and that, trying to, you see that old baby last night? Trying to walk? No more. Fall down on the butt every time. Amen. And that's what we can't do. That's what Satan wants us to do right now, is to sit on our butts. Don't take that first step. But once you take that first step, it's just from my experience, when you take that first step, it's almost like gliding. It's almost like, woo, you get a little bit strutting. No, I'm just kidding. But it's almost like your feet's not moving, your legs not moving. Mm-hmm. When you take that first, just one step toward an altar of prayer. Because when you step out, you'll remember that first step out, you won't remember nothing else. Amen. You don't remember nothing then. You might. I can't speak to you. I didn't. Amen. But just one step. Just one step. Amen. Just one step. In Psalms 119, the 131st verse says this: "Direct my steps by your word, and let no iniquity have dominion over me." Amen. Iniquity, the sin have dominion over you? Does this world have dominion over you? Psalmist says, "Lord, direct my steps." Jesus is telling us this morning, you take the first step, then I'll direct your steps. Amen. You don't take the first steps, you're still in your iniquity. Amen. We can be standing all over the house. We're not even going to have a song of invitation this morning. Amen. Just one step. Just one step is all it took to get that one look you need for salvation. Just one step is all it took for that one look when you know your salvation is bought and paid for. We're not going to tarry long.